16 years. When she first started here, she did lots of printmaking. And then she moved into working on wood, where she really sanded it back, lots of layers, stuck things on, lots of lacquers and things like that, and some gorgeous surfaces. It was very interesting. Inks even tipped on them. Got a few of those pieces. And then in more recent years, she has moved into this, working with this paper, and she's been drilling holes and tearing. And in the catalogue essay, Andrew Gaynor speaks of this as being her tough love. And I think that her tough love has raised some very beautiful offspring in there as well. And I think it's the actual creative process with Melinda's work, where she does have this vigorous working of the media that she works with, but then the output of that are these beautiful compositions and this tranquility in the actual work, despite the harshness with which she treats her media. So I think this exhibition is a stunning one. She's really outdone herself with this. Mel is in numerous collections, including the National Gallery of Australia, Geelong Regional Gallery. She's in the Royal Art Museum at Antwerp, Belgium.
Claire's house.
Oh, my house. So I'm really looking forward to hearing more about her process. Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Pleasure.
Of course, I have to say thank you to Mel and Claire for putting on a show like this. And I don't know if a lot of people understand what goes on behind the scenes and getting this organised, and dealing with artists as well. That's challenging at best. But I just want to thank you all for coming out and supporting this as well, because an artist talk can be quite intimidating for the artist, especially with lots of familiar faces. And but I think it's really important to bridge the gap between what we do and what isolated circumstances and what you see here. I think it's a bit of mystery there, and we don't want to give away all the secrets, but certainly you can share some of that information and make it, you know, make everyone feel involved. And we need to show the Liberal government that the arts are actually worth supporting. Are we all agree?
Yeah.
Good, good. We're on the same page. Caroline, I think this work is incredible, and it's densely, it just dense and rich layers. And I have to say, I love a studio envy right about now, because we're here compared to Caroline. So it's a little bit of a difference there. So beautiful, and quite a, you'll see with the slides, I have quite a crossover in our inspiration. So yes, I'll try to.
I'm a huge fan. Oh. Sorry to mention that earlier.
Hiding my words. Thank you. So I'll try to keep it short and sweet, hopefully informative. We'd like to pass the champagne at some stage today. So Anita's going to be in control of my slides, and what I want to really focus on is the notion of inspiration. Because I think there are many things that you could talk about, but this is probably one of the mysteries in terms of how you go, how the seed of inspiration sprouts into an image and backs an entire show of images. How do you make that connect the dots between the two? So that's what I'm going to focus on today. It's not an easy topic to articulate, otherwise you'd probably hear a lot more artists doing that. And I also agree to a certain extent with Chuck Close, an American artist that you've probably heard of, who actually believes that inspiration is for amateurs and the rest of us just get to work. There's a degree of truth and honesty in that, because a lot of making this work is hard work. There's a lot of labor involved, particularly the way I work. I use a lot of power tools. Like Claire mentioned, there is a lot of tough love involved in this, and there's a lot of physicality. I use a scalpel, a drill. I use a lot of heavy weights to weigh the paper down, moving them up and down, and so on. So it is quite sort of strenuous at times. But at the same time, you have to have a starting point. You have to have a lot of self-reflection. That takes a lot of time. And you need time to edit, as Andrew Gaynor suggested in my on the window. So I'm going to start by emphasizing that inspiration is actually all around. It doesn't have to be a grand moment, it doesn't have to, you stop you in your tracks. Often it's the very ordinary things, day-to-day observations. If you just keep yourself open and be curious about the world, the inspiration will actually find you. So photography for me is a massive, plays a massive role in my work, both before, during, and after series. So we're just going to go through a few slides just to give you an idea of some things that are closer to home. I spent a lot of time down in Vincente Head along the bay, if anyone's familiar with that area. And a lot of sea life and images you could probably see in this work. So travel also plays a big role in what I do. I've been traveling for a very long time, spending a lot of time overseas, home again, overseas again. And now we're a little bit more grounded, I would say, but still take the opportunity to travel whenever I can. And some of these shots were from Queensland. You might recognize some of the patterning. A lot of that comes from them. Crabs. We went to Thailand last year as well. We found those crabs again. Lots of little still moments that I've captured with the camera. We went to New Zealand at the start of this year, a land full of amazing contrasts. This is the South Island of New Zealand, absolutely incredible. And you can see also the connection to the water and to the land there. Okay, so you might have read on the invite, my initial inspiration for the entire series was actually this nursery spider web. Has anyone seen this before? No, I hadn't either. So up and down the coastlines of the South Island while we were there were these little puffs of cotton on all the tips of the trees and branches. I sort of just, they were ubiquitous, so I just made mention that, I took a photo. I love them. I love the ugliness and the beauty of that, and that really sort of struck me. So I photographed it. It also seemed to be suffocating the plant life underneath. And then I came home and I realized actually those webs are, I did some research, those webs actually are protecting the young. The mother spider lays the eggs and protects them in that web. And so conceptually it struck a chord with me as well. So it's that confluence of ideas that go from an image like that, the web. Can we go back to the web, please? So to go from that to this whole series of work is sort of what I want to talk about now. The magic for me happens when I stopped. I had coffee, but I had that much coffee. So the magic for me is when these images, they go from observations or photographs into something that I transform along the way. So the representational doesn't really interest me so much, but reality does. So, but then how does that get transformed in the studio is how these images come to be. Right, so these are all sort of the... Right, so I'm just going to show a little clip just to show, just so you can see the technical side of how these works are made. After I've documented the image and I've worked in the studio, it's really time to take Chuck Close's advice and get to work. Right? So this is what happens when I get to work. In fast. So a lot of this notion of the cocoon commuting to work in FASMO, and the inspiration continues when I'm actually in the studio, because that still plays that quiet part to actually get those images processed in them, because it is quite labor intensive. I need a lot of that time to process through. And what I do in the studio is listen to lots of podcasts and lots of music, which can be really good and really bad in the sense that I look outside, like that's how I stay connected to the world and what's going on, and it's a little bit screwed up right now. So it's those ideas that come through. A lot of those images, whether they're or thoughts, whether they're positive or negative, sort of get filtered through the process itself. So while I'm working, tearing, drilling, I sort of can process that and bring positivity back into my life, into my mind, through the process that I use. Outside of the studio, we have a lot of bird life. Those from Eltham might be able to attest to this. Lots of songs as well, if I just turn the music and the podcast off. There's plenty of inspiration there as well. I just want to make a note as well that the actual materials that I use, I think it's really important to have respect for those materials, because if you invest in proper materials and you really know them well, I love the papers and I love the inks and the pencil and everything that I use. I try to keep it simple in terms of, because I can tend to get carried away with experimentation. So if I just sort of keep those key ingredients and use them well and treat them well, and everything, I think it results in a higher quality of work as well. In April, I got to spend 10 glorious days at the Art Vault in Mildura. If anyone's familiar with that area or place, yes, a few family members, yes. No distractions. Sorry. No cooking. None of the domestic chores, which I love. I could stay up past 10 o'clock. I worked through the night. It was really amazing. And again, in terms of liberal cuts to the arts, I mean, those sort of programs are incredible for artists. I can't stress it strongly enough. It's like a support of this, it's just to be able to do those sorts of programs away from your day to day, just takes it to another place, allowed me to do all of this, really, in that space of time. I didn't finish it all there, but I certainly started a great deal of it. So while I was there, I had a little bit of time to wander around a bit. And so those images have also been incorporated into the work. So whether that's conscious or subconscious, I don't know, but just incredible landscapes again. I'm always responding to the landscape for sure. I just can't help it. But again, it may not be all beautiful things. There could be some not so beautiful things in there, which keeps it interesting. So that's the studio floor in Mildura. Speaking of distractions, my biggest inspirations as well, my harshest critics, but also what keeps me grounded and reminds me not to take myself too seriously. That's important as well. Thanks.
That's fine. Thank you.
Yes, so my main, yes, so everything's on paper, it's all 640 gram paper. I have two different types, there's a French paper and an Italian paper that you can use for that sort of thing. And that allows me to tear very deeply into the paper if I choose to, or not so much, but it gives you depth. Because the paper actually feels a bit like board. It's a hot press paper, so it's very smooth as well, so you can have the nice contrast of the torn layer with the very smooth paper. Inks are pretty much all I use, similar to Caroline, but I dilute the ink, so and sometimes use them in their opaque way as well, and they're incredible. They can do so many things, and I try to stick with just that. And pencil. That's pretty much it.
How do you switch from the been so utterly involved with that, to then love when the kids come home from school or whatever. How else can you switch over?
Yeah, look,
is it a sort of a slow process or a quick process?
It really varies. My headspace varies quite a bit. I think I've gotten better at it. Like anything, you can learn to get better at it. You just deal with, you know, everything that comes in, and you just have to be very disciplined, very organized, and you just get in there and just do the work, maybe say no to a few coffees. And yeah, just get to work every day, same as anybody else doing to get something done. And the more effort I've decided, you know, coming back to Australia this last time, we've been here now nearly 5 years again this time, and it's just been critical to my art practice because it's really settled me. I do need that travel and I need that inspiration and I need that novelty, but if I don't sit and be still for a little while, the work just doesn't come. So now I have to get in there and do that same thing almost every day if I can. It is hard to switch. They're obviously in it.
Do you find if you're brimming with ideas, mm-hmm. you do you record stuff or?
Yes. That's where the camera really does come in handy. And the camera, interestingly, I've always loved photography anyway, but in terms of documenting ideas, it really does that beautifully for me because it captures a fleeting moment. So the magic for me happens when I come away with those ideas and then I transform them with the works on paper, but the camera plays a big role in that. But also writing things down, taking notes, a little, always. No, I drop the kids where they walk and I just take them. My studio is at my house, so it's the bottom floor, so it makes it very convenient. I think that's the only way it would really work for me. It's just too many. Although, Caroline.
I do great G&Ts.
How do you transform yourself into the drill? Where does that come from?
The drill, yeah.
Is it on YouTube?
No. I mean, the crabs were an inspiration for that, yeah. But I was using a power drill initially, and that was like, I was going to fall off, so that was kind of silly. And then I found the Dremel. My dad came for a visit. And he said, you need to go get an engraving tool, and it'll be much easier on your arm and your wrist. So that's what I did, the Dremel tool. That's wonderful. It's an engraving tool, and you can change the tips of the tool on the tool and create all different textures with those holes in the arms. Look, they are, but they're not so interested in helping me. That's the problem. So, yeah. No, I think particularly she loves to draw and sit there, but probably I think after a bit of time that will come. Right now it's just my thing. We just decided to do what I want to. What do you think of me? You can answer for yourself.
All right, well, thank you so much, Mel. If anyone's got any questions, just pin it down. She'll be at the wine table.
I need a drink. How are we all doing?
All right, thanks so much, both of you.